Mary, Leslie, thank you for the invitation to speak on lessons from Norway on local democracy. And I see some familiar faces, so I think it's Norwegians here. And that's some of the part of it. We are so small country, we know each other, we recognize each other. So I saw it in the lobby and I understand it's Norwegians here. So small countries, people-sized countries. It's a pleasure, also personal for me, to be in Scotland. My mother, she was an au pair in the 60s at Barbara and Kenneth Kelly in Dumfries. My best family holiday during childhood and when I was young, that was a nice week in Scotland in 1990. And in 1999, I organized a study trip. That means Barbara Kelly actually organized it to Scotland. And we had a nice visit with agriculture, with the devolution process, with landscape and castles and military tattoo. And of course, a lot of music and dancing and partying all night because of the cultural festival in Edinburgh. The last visit I had in Scotland was in 2004 with my wife and my firstborn. And my firstborn is now a pen friend with Barbara Kelly's granddaughter. It's a long time ago, so it's definitely time to come back to Scotland. And as Barbara Kelly always says when we meet, we have to keep up the good relationship between Scotland and Norway. So, when I was invited, I had to say yes. But the topic, lessons from Norway. Do we actually have some lessons from Norway, and do we actually have some pictures? Perhaps. It's on here.
That's something
in there. What's coming?
There we go.
Okay. First, a few words about KS before going to lessons from Norway. KS is the only employers' association and interest organization for municipalities, counties, and local public enterprises in Norway. And all of the councils and all of the counties are a member of KS. And KS, we advocate the interests of our members towards central government, parliament, labor organization, and others. And we also conduct central collective negotiations on behalf of our members. And also, we act as an advisory and consultative body. And as COSLA, we are a political organization represented by delegates from the 11,000 local politicians. So, lessons from Norway. Do we have some basis for teaching others? I found one interesting report. It was the Economist Intelligence Unit's Democracy Index 2016. And there, Norway is ranked as number one. Norway has been ranked as number one for the six last years. So perhaps we have some basis of teaching others. UK is ranked as number 16. Every one of the other Nordic countries are on the list of the top 10 in the world. Local democracy is an important part of the total Norwegian democracy. And it's crucial for building confidence in the Norwegian society. So I will argue that one of the reasons Norway is ranked high is because of the local and regional governments in Norway. I will start with the interaction between local and national government and give a short brief on the merging processes. Then I'll go into why municipalities have succeeded. And finally, I will say something about how KS as an organization has developed and supported local democracy. the relationship between the local and the national level, I call it the long tradition of love and hate, because that's how it is. But we have to start somewhere, and the point we start is the people. People is the one giving the mandate, and then give the mandate directly to the parliament, of course, but also directly to the councils and counties. Norway is a unitary state, but the local and regional delegated authority is established by parliament through legislation. But at the same time, municipalities and counties are independent elected levels of government with mandate from citizens through elections every 4 years. One point of this I would like to stress is that councils and counties are formally equal, and not so they are, the counties is not have not the possibility to overrule the councils. They are at the same level. So we have a two-level system in Norway, the national and the local and regional. And also it's important to stress that the local and regional authorities are not part of the hierarchical central government. Therefore, the local and regional authorities are not subject to other state organs than parliament. And we know that, but and this is how it is. But we, our experience is that we have to remind often national politicians and civil servants that it's only the parliament and not the central government that can instruct the local councils and the counties. The municipality's history is also a history of Norway, from great poverty to prosperity. Local and regional governments have increasingly got broader responsibilities, and Norway is characterized by a highly decentralized problem solving. And I will argue that also in the future, innovative and inclusive social societal actors at local level are the most efficient way to also meet and to solve national challenges. To meet the challenges, then we have the recent years have the process of merging. And the question is to merge or not to merge. That's been the question for the recent years in Norway. But what was the question? And the question is how to solve the problem of scale. The problem of scale is that the municipalities has over time received more responsibilities and more tasks that together exceed its capacity to solve them by themselves. And then you have to choose how to solve the problem then. And in the historical way to do it in Norway has been to cooperate between municipalities. Everybody cooperates on the child care provision, on how to develop the society, how to deal with problems that are cross-border. So everybody is cooperating, small municipalities and large municipalities. So that has been the local answer of coping with the problem of scale. Also, another way of solution is that the national government tries to make standards and try to steer how the local and regional authorities will fix the problems. But now, for the last years, there's been a shift so that the politicians thinks it's better to have an amalgamation process to merge the municipalities so that you can meet the tasks with your own capacity and not will be dependent on cooperation with other ones. So, what has been the result to meet the problem of scale by merging? And today, it is like 94 municipalities have made mutual decisions to merge. that number can be higher because even these weeks, some councils, they negotiate and perhaps they will merge to a new municipality. But this process have led to a reduction from 428 to 373 municipalities. That the number of the ones who wanted to merge is larger. It's about 150 and 160, but they did not get a willing partner to merge with. So that's why it's 94 municipalities that have mutual decisions to merge. But that's not enough, thinks the national politicians. So they will use force in 13 cases so that it will lead to a reduction to 358 municipalities. And the answer of the question we will get later in the spring when the parliament will decide upon this new structure. Our position has been that the structural changes must be based on local processes. And it has been a large and huge and comprehensive involvement in the local processes. Perhaps the most comprehensive involvement on any time at one single issue in the local and regional history. The Local Government Boundaries Act states that inhabitants should be consulted before the municipal councils make resolutions concerning potential mergers. And that can be by referendums, opinion polls, meetings, or similar activities. Many municipalities choose to use surveys, and others wanted to use referendum. And some used both of it. And the result is that 229 municipalities actually had surveys, and that was to find out what do people think about the problem of scale. Should we continue by cooperate with other ones, or should we merge with other ones, and in what direction? Which one do we think we should merge with? And in the result of it, we are researching on it now, but I'll guess that in half of these cases, people said yes to merge, and half they said no. And in 72 cases, the council overruled what was the people's choice. But interestingly, the most cases, it was an overrule from when people said yes, and then the council said no. But that's quite opposite from the referendum. And many chose referendum later in the process when it was clearer which one to merge. And then the answer is easier. Is it yes or is it no? So that's why many wanted to have a referendum late in the process. And about half of the municipalities chose to have a referendum, 210 out of 428. And about half of them in the people said no to merge, and half said yes. And in 29 cases, the people's vote was overruled by the council. And here, in most cases, it was overruled from the people's no to the council's yes. So the result is a slightly larger municipalities in Norway. If you look at the merging municipalities, we have an average going from 14,000 people to 36,000 people, and a median from 5 to 23,000, so quite significant change. But if you take the total picture, the average only moves from 12,000 to 14,600, and the median from 4,600 to 5,100, and that is not so much difference from what it is today. Also, at the regional level, it's structural reform. Six counties made mutual decisions to merge. Then it moved from 19 to 16 counties. And here as well, it's a political agreement to go further. And here they will use force a little bit more. and they will go from 16 to 10 to 11 regions. And that will be decided this spring. So much for the structure. But why have the municipalities and the counties been successful so far? And the answer is that it all comes down to trust and confidence in the politicians. Trust is in political institutions is an essential component of well-functioning democracies. And the Norwegian mystery, the Norwegian welfare mystery is that local and regional authorities have been given more and more responsibility and more tasks, both from the national parliament and from citizens, but without decline in the level of trust. And if you look in the United States and Europe, the popular trust in governments, in institutions, in political parties and politicians, there has been declining for decades, but that has not been the situation in Norway. So that is the mystery. Why? And to try to answer that question, I have to start with some basics, and that is the values of Norwegians. And one of the core values of Norwegians is freedom. Freedom. Freedom from state override. It's a very strong value that touches the deepest notion of what local democracy means. But freedom from also affects freedom of underfunded reforms. So it's about money. And freedom from is therefore also strongly linked to a sense of bondage because of unrealistic expectations created through national politicians' promises on behalf of local politicians. But freedom too is another thing. And freedom too is primarily related to the freedom to prioritize in line with local political wishes. The main significance of the concept of liberty still seems to be the freedom to provide adequate services and freedom of local adaptation. And if you ask, we have asked people, politicians and staff and citizens without that not are politicians themselves. And for the non-elected citizens, the freedom too is closely related to that it is possible to influence the provision of services, both politically and in contact with service agencies and personnel. And this is crucial. And it's also interesting to note that this interest rarely emerges as a consumer orientation, but it is an expression of ownership of municipal public goods, and that people feel that they are a part of to manage the relevant knowledge, to manage the resources. This is not them, it's us. So we are part of it. We are part of our municipality. So we need to control it from below. And that is very important value for the citizens in Norway. So that leads us to the explanation. It's about sufficient money, freedom from underfunded reforms, freedom to meet local prioritizations. And it's also autonomy. It's the municipality's responsibility is strongly linked to local knowledge, but this responsibility can only be realized if the municipality has a real opportunity to prioritize independence in accordance to that local knowledge. So autonomy is important. And that is what the national parliament and the central government can help us with to get enough sufficient economy and also give sufficient autonomy. But also it's the importance of for the people to control the local authorities, to control the politics. Because the municipality is not perceived as a completely remote and inaccessible bureaucratic system. The municipality is accessible and it's possible to control or at least influence and to correct. And in Norway, many people are almost uncompromisingly committed to the right and ability to influence decisions. And what people fear more than anything else is distance and inaccessibility. It isn't like that people are running to the town hall and to say, I want to participate. But if they feel that they don't have the ability to participate in what's important for them, then they will let their voices heard. It's classic, it's loyalty, voice, and exit. So we have to have a system that the voices can be listened to. In other case, people will exit. So, but in between what the national governments can do and what the people can control from below, we have this political added value that local politicians can add to the system of trust. And the local elected officials have an opportunity to refute criticism in the public sphere, but also in direct conversation with citizens. And they can explain the dilemmas that everybody can't get in everything. We don't have resources to meet everybody's needs. We have to make prioritization. And to meet people and to express this and to talk with people, they get understanding by the citizens. We know each other because we have 11,000 politicians. We know each other. My wife is a politician, so I can go. I don't have to go to town hall. I can take it at breakfast. So it's easy. And my friends are politicians. I was a counselor myself in the 90s. So we are all political. So that's a part of us. But also, it's a very interesting thing is that local political conflicts also have a special ability to inspire confidence. And this is quite interesting because in Norway, we don't have a position and opposition. We have a coalition. In the executive board, the point is that every interest in the society should be at the board that makes decisions. So everyone will be heard at the table. That's important. And that means also that we have shifting majorities on different issues. So you're not stuck with one party and some parties. We shift interests. And also, when you decide something, the responsibility is not for some people in a long time from now on. It's concrete, it's right here and it's right now. And the responsibility is for the people you know. It's for the family, it's for your friends, it's for the people you meet at the grocery. So it's people you actually know. We know each other. We recognize each other. And in this way, when you have conflicts, the conflicts, they will are rarely fundamentalistic. So that means that you know it will be conflicts, but that is professional in some sort of way. So it's nothing to be scared of. Political conflict is normal. That's what we do. We meet at Rotary and that we meet at parent cooperation and everything. But when we meet at the table to make prioritizations, then we are competitors. But that's okay, we know. So we build, it's a form of building trust to each other, that we know the role that everyone has in different situations. So, I will say a little bit about what KS do. Of course, we are a spokesperson to secure local freedom. This is our board. We work with government, we work with parliament, and we have dialogue with our members and documentation, our own experts, we have a research institute, but I don't. I will not go into to this. I will go into what we do together with our members. Our starting point is normative. We have to have a platform. What is good local democracy? If we don't have some, we don't know what to achieve. We must be agree upon what to achieve. Good local democracy has been discussed for 2,500 years, and it still will be discussed. So we asked several experts, different experts, to help us with what is good local democracy. And then we put together a platform with some key elements. And perhaps most important is that citizens feel well represented, and that it's the councillors that set the agenda, and that the municipality delivers what it promises. And the last point is that democracy is not only political processes, it's also political outcome. If you don't deliver, people will not trust the governments. So you have to deliver. And then we moved to from normative to the empirical. Well, how is it? And then we have developed some standards and indicators. We have developed a practical tool so that the local municipalities themselves can ask their citizens, how do you evaluate our local democracy in our municipality? And this also, the results is in a national open database. And these days we are introducing the new survey. 20 municipalities so far have said yes, we will, and we have the capacity to do it for 100 municipalities. And then we check the reliability, the accountability, the efficiency, and also if people feel that the municipality is close to the citizens. And most satisfied, the people are most satisfied with the efficiency and in what the council actually delivers, but they are least satisfied with the possibility to influence. And that is very important, because if the possibility to influence is at the core of building trust, and the citizens are not satisfied with that, then we have to really do something to have better connections with our citizens. And then we do some analysis. Here is just one example. When we have said all of the data on what is the evaluation that the citizens have on each municipality compared to all other statistics that we have access to, then we got some interesting results. One result, and the easy way out is just to remember three things, because if you have a high level of trust, then you don't have to organize so much. Then all things go smooth. So it comes down to three key elements. It's culture and structure and information. And it's the political culture. If you have a culture that have a high degree of mutual trust between the municipal councillors, that is very important. And that makes the communication between stakeholders more smooth, gives room for good discussions and good decisions, and makes the implementation easier. And the role of the mayor is mentioned as particularly important, because people watch the political debates, and if they feel that this is nonsense or they don't deal with each other in a proper way, they will think that the democracy is not so good. So, and that you can do yourself. You can be an all right person also being a politician. So that will influence on how people view the local politics. And also it's openness, transparency, and inclusion of political parties that are in opposition. That are also elements that create mutual trust. Structure. Our experience indicates that the importance of clear and formal organizational structure, and more important, the importance of clear lines of responsibility. So knowing who are responsible for what at different stages in the decision-making process is important to the citizens' evaluation of efficiency, accountability, and reliability. Information. Making arrangements for informing citizens about decision-making processes, decisions voted on, the arguments for or against different alternative decisions, as well as information about the implementation of decisions, that may enhance citizens' view on local democratic governance. So, if you just keep on building a culture of trust and make sure that the structure have clear lines of responsibility and that you have a lot of information to the citizens, then you are you have a democracy that are better off than today. What we do is that we feed this back to the local councillors. We have a councillor training program in the first years of the mandate period, and we call the program Trust, and that says it all. It all comes down to trust. 2 days plus 1 day plus 1 day follow-up, 2 days in the start of the period. Then we focus on the political leadership, how it is to be to represent citizens, how to lead the political community, how to control the administration, and how to secure that the inhabitants get results from the municipality. We also give advice in different, like financial compensation, because it's up to the councils and counties themselves to make the to decide the compensation that the councillors get. And it's important for us that it is compensation and not wages as the staff, because it's something else. You are not a staff, you are not a part of the administration, you are something else, you are a politician, and you get compensation for it. Mayors are the only one that are full-time politicians. That means in the larger cities there might be more. And what they get is comparable to the national politicians, and that will be about £90,000 a year. Deputy mayors are part-time compensated, and other elected officials, they get between £10 and £100 pounds per meeting. But the ones that are group leaders or committee leaders, they get more paid. But it's modest. So the thinking is that this is something you do in addition to the ordinary work, the ordinary life, so we get some compensation for it. If it takes so much time that you have to get that you can't work full time, then you get compensation for it. So it's not nobody become a politician because of the money. We have asked the people why being a candidate for the council, and they say that it is because we want to participating on making a better society. Some people want to control the administration, but and some think about it's a first step at the political career, but the overall answer is that we feel it's our turn, it's my turn to participate in building this place where I live as a better place for me and my dearest and nearest. Other things, we have a hotline for service for advice and consultation for all the politicians and the chief executives. And they, 4 or 5 calls every day on different things, but we try to help, and that means listening mostly. We also focus on political leadership, participation in and between elections. We support volunteerism, and we have an extensive toolbook on ethics. And here's a picture of the Committee on Ethics in the Local Government Sector. It's led by a former minister and governor, county governor, we call it, and also mayors and professionals and Transparency International. So that is, well, they are some kind of watchdog for on the ethics in the municipal sector. And we also cooperate with Transparency International on several tools to protect the municipality. So here is an example, anti-corruption handbook. But when it comes to the future, the years ahead, I think that the major challenge for us is to avoid, and for perhaps other countries, to combat the growing disconnect between the people and the ones that represent them. That means we have to be better to respond to the people's hankering to be heard, to be represented, and to have their views taken seriously. Because we know that the citizens in Norway, at least, are very concerned that there are independent local bodies. That means relatively autonomous, people-controlled municipalities that is possible to get in touch with and attempt to hold accountable in relation to genuinely local political priorities. So what we have put on the agenda for the years to come is to develop a more inclusive democracy. And that calls upon the national political leaders to actually decentralize responsibility and power to the local and regional authorities. And it also calls upon local politicians to exercise leadership, and that will be a more inclusive political style of leadership. But I'm sure that together, the national and the local politicians will be able to develop and build a more inclusive societies, and also to develop a more inclusive democracy. So that is what I was thinking of letting you know. So thank you for listening.